Welcome to the webinar, Implementing Inspire with FME. My name is Jürgen Dubke. I'm working for Conterra as a consultant and software engineer for more than 10 years now. The main focus of my work is on using FME to solve all the tasks that the Inspire Directive brings to our customers. For example, I have developed the Inspire Solution Pack, which is an add-on for FME. I assume that everyone here is familiar with Inspire. Maybe for those of you who are new to Inspire, Inspire is a European directive that was passed by the European Commission in 2007 and is legally binding in the member states. The goal of Inspire is to establish interoperability and ease reporting obligations. To reach these goals, there are several tasks that need to be addressed by the involved organizations. The main tasks are listed on these slides, so there's the harmonization of spatial data as Inspire data themes, the publication of spatial data sets as Inspire view services or download services, the creation and publication of Inspire metadata. And then there are some additional tasks like the monitoring, access control, e-commerce structures, and providing access to the data through a geoportal. FME is a great tool and can support all of these tasks, but since time is limited, I will focus on some of the aspects today. These are the ones that, in my opinion, are the most difficult ones and the ones where FME is best suited to solve the problem. In my experience, the data transformation makes up the biggest part of the work in most Inspire projects. The data comes from various information systems in different formats and data structures and has to be transformed into the Inspire data model. This usually requires to have a deep knowledge of the Inspire data models. So we try to make this process easier by building an add-on to FME we call the Inspire Solution Pack. It brings a lot of the information that is needed to perform the transformation directly into the workbench. I will demonstrate how this works using an example data set from Lower Saxony. The data set covers earthquake events, and I will transform this data set into the NX3 Inspire data theme Natural Risk Zone. So let me switch to FME here. As you can see, my FME already has a few additional transformer galleries with transformers with the only purpose to provide or to make the transformation into the Inspire data models easier. The categories are ordered by Inspire NX theme. And usually it's not necessary to really go into the categories and put the transformers into your workspace, as in most cases, it is easier to use one of the templates that also ship with the Inspire Solution Pack. So I can go to new and we'll find the installed templates in the web category. So here are the templates if you want to provide data for the Inspire GeoDatabase model that comes with ArcGIS for Inspire, or with if you want to write Inspire GML directly, there are templates for all the NX themes to do this. In our case, I said we are going to write Inspire GML for natural risk zones, so I can choose the Inspire GML natural risk zones template, or I can go to the FME hub where I usually find the most up-to-date version of the templates. Whenever we find errors or we update the templates, we put them on the hub so that you can always find the newest version there. Yes, the template already has the target schema and the target writer predefined in the template, so we find all the feature types that belong to the NX theme natural risk zones here, the risk zone, the hazard area, the exposed element, and the observed event. And there are already a number of Inspire transformers connected with the feature types. So this means to start with our mapping, we should first add the source data, which come in an Excel file. Maybe look at the parameters to see if everything works out fine. So the data set has information about the year, the month, the day, the hour of the quake, earthquake, the geographical position. Then we have the intensity, we have an ID, we have a location, and so on. What is quite important here is that Breite and Länge, which transform to an X and Y coordinate, already have the correct data type specified so that we can directly use the data as spatial data, even if Excel is a non-spatial format, so that we can directly put the data on the map and work with the data like any spatial format. After loading the data, I can connect it with the template to the observed event, which is what our source data is, earthquake events. And then I can go through the different Inspire transformers and just fill out the missing information. So first of all, I have to put in the namespace, which I can put, for instance, DE for Germany, and then NZ or ST for Lower Saxony, and then NZ for instance for natural risk zones, and then quakes for earthquakes. I mean, this is really up to the organization that provides the data set. In Germany, usually there's also the URL of the registry before the DE.ST and so on. So this really depends on the organization which provides the data and also on the country where the data is from. Yeah, then for the local identifier, I can just use the identifier from the original data set, which is the ID. And then we have the version ID that is only used if you also provide historical data. So if you have different versions of the same data item, which we don't have. So in this case, I can also go to the drop-down menu and say, okay, set this void, the reason it is unpopulated, click okay. And this was already the first transformer. Next one is again about the historic information of the data, which we don't have. So this is about the lifespan of the data objects. And again, here we can say, okay, we don't have this information. So we can say it's unpopulated in both cases. Click okay, and we are done with the lifespan. Next transformer is for the attributes valid from and valid to. For data which has a limited validity, but also our data doesn't have these attributes, so I can choose void unpopulated again here and here. Okay, let's see what the next transformer is. This is the natural hazard classification hazard category, and here the choice is quite easy. Basically asking for the type of hazard that we have in our data. And in this case, it's quite easy. It's an earthquake. So I select earthquake here, click OK. And that is also already with a predefined part of the mapping. I can run the workspace now and see if we get some proper GML. Or maybe it's a good idea also to have a look at the source data first. Okay, as you can see, we have table with the source data here that has all the properties that I already showed before, like the ID, the location, the intensity, and so on. And on the map, you can see that it's located inside of Lower Saxony in Germany. So everything worked fine here. So we can have a look at the transformed data of these 81 earthquake events. I will just open the data in Notepad. And here we find all the information that we gave to the process when creating the data. We have the local ID, we have the namespace, we have the hazard category, valid from, the lifespan, and the position. You can also see that there are still some attributes missing. This is the individual part of the mapping that we still have to do. So I go back to the workspace and finalize the mapping. If I'm not sure what attributes might still be missing, I can also click on the UML diagram link here in the workspace, which gives me access to the UML diagram, which shows the data model for that NX theme. So I can see here that, for instance, I'm still missing the magnitude and intensity on my observed event. I have the geometry, I have the inspire ID, I have the type of hazard, I have begin and end lifespan version already. I'm also still missing the name of the event, and then I have valid from and valid to. In this case, I don't have any proper attribute for name of event in my source data, so I will only provide the magnitude or intensity. It's not a problem that I don't have the name because it's voidable, so it's okay to not provide a value there. And all I have to do to provide the magnitude or intensity is, for instance, use an attribute manager. Simply type into the workspace canvas, drag it onto the connection, and then create the attributes. Since I already have the intensity in my source data, I can simply rename it. Here I have the magnitude or intensity. And since we have a quantitative value, I can just select this here. The curly brackets indicate that there's a possibility to provide more than one value for that attribute. Since we only have one, we can just put a zero here and we're fine. And then for the unit, there's another attribute that we need to provide, which is the quantitative value dot UOM. Again, to provide the zero for the list. And that's it already. So by providing these two values, FME will provide the magnitude or intensity in the GML file. Just have to rewrite it, and then I'm done. Or maybe we can also switch on validation to see if our file conforms to the GML schema for natural risk zones. Rerun the workspace. Okay, if I scroll up here a bit, I see the results from the validation. As you can see, there were zero warnings and zero errors. So at least against the schema, our data is valid. Of course, this is not as powerful as the ETF validator, which might still find errors, but this is another part. At least against the schema, our data is valid. You can also have a look at the GML. And here we find our quantitative value for the level of intensity. Yeah, and that's it already. So we have transformed this file into Inspire GML. I think this process showed that transforming a dataset with FME becomes even simpler if you have a pre-configured template. The complexity of the individual part was very low in this case, but this depends a lot on the Inspire theme and the source data sets. More complex source data sets usually have a more complex individual mapping part. The Inspire solution pack for FME provides templates for all NX themes, and these templates have the Inspire transformers, help, and code lists already in the workbench. The templates can be used on FME desktop, server, and cloud, and you can get the latest version from the FME hub, either as GML or as Inspire GeoDatabase for S3. Another aspect of the Inspire implementation that FME is really good with is automation. It is important to keep the harmonized datasets up to date if the source dataset changes. to check and update services that are running on a software like ArcGIS for Inspire or by simply updating the files for an Atom feed. Many organizations we work with use FME to centralize data processing. The processes can this way be hosted in a central location, and different departments or even people from outside the organization can be empowered to upload datasets, which are then transformed to Inspire data. Another important aspect is validation. FME can be used for different kinds of validation. More about that in the next slide. It really makes sense to use FME Server to automatically validate services and data from time to time to ensure a stable environment and to make sure that the environment conforms to the quality of service requirements from Inspire. As I said, FME can be used in many different ways to support different kinds of validation. There are some obvious ones like attribute values or data types like geometry and of course schema validation using the GML or Inspire writers. There's also a transformer on the FME hub to directly use the ETF value data from FME. But I think the most important point and one of the biggest advantages of FME is that it cannot only detect these errors, but that it also gives you the tools to fix almost any of the problems you might discover. And it is also important to have validation rules relevant to your own data as well, not just the Inspire rules. FME provides a lot of flexibility to support this. So in summary, FME supports the Inspire implementation in many ways. Today I have focused on data harmonization, validation, and automation. But as I said, there's many more things that you can do with FME when you implement Inspire. If you want to learn more about this, visit contera.de or follow us on social media. Thank you very much and talk to you soon.